بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الخلق والمرسلين، سيدنا وحبيبنا وشفيعنا وقدوتنا وقرة أعيننا ونور قلوبنا، ومولانا محمد صلى الله تعالى عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا كثيرا. أما بعد، السلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته. All praise belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the choicest of blessings upon Sayyiduna, our master, wa habibuna, our beloved, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. The topic that I would like to address today, Jamaatul Muslimin, and I want to jump straight into it, is the importance, the virtue, the benefit, the fruits, and also the manner in which a person should make dua when turning to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in prayer or supplication. You know, we are living in a time where the importance of dua is very much undermined. We don't realize the importance of dua. You know, today everybody taking the international events into consideration, the suffering of Muslims around the world, one very often feels very helpless. You know, and we ignore the fact that we have the strongest weapon on our side. Our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said that dua is silahul mu'min. It's the true weapon of a believer is the dua, that when he turns and calls and speaks to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So I want to touch on the importance, the fruits, the benefits, the virtue of turning and making dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and also the prescribed manner, the sunnah, and the manner in which a person turns to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when making dua. One of the immediate benefits of dua, and important for us to understand, is that dua is an act of worship. It's an act of obedience. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Ghafir that وَقَالَ رَبُّكُمُ دَعُونِي أَسْتَجِبْ لَكُمْ وَقَالَ رَبُّكُمُ دَعُونِي أَسْتَجِبْ لَكُمْ. Your Lord has said unto you, Ud'uni, turn to me in dua. And the important point immediately to make is that the form of the verb that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses here is an injunction. It's a command. Turn to me in dua. Allah is not saying if you wish then make dua. Allah is making it incumbent upon us. Go, turn to me in dua. Pray to me. Supplicate. Astajib lakum, I will answer your prayer. In another verse in Surah Al-A'raf, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَدَعُوهُ مُخْلِصِينَ لَهُ الدِّينَ. Turn to Allah in dua, sincerely seeking from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the person from the very outset, when he turns to Allah making dua, number one, he is obedient in that he is fulfilling a command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is fulfilling an injunction that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us in the Quran. Another benefit of turning to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in dua is that the person who does so, he is guaranteed to be free of that faulty quality of kibr, of being haughty and proud. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, again in Surah Ghafir, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, Udu'uni astajib lakum, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Inna alladhina yastakbiruna an ibadati. Those people who are filled with pride to the degree that they cannot do my worship. And the worship that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala refers to here is dua. Those people, they are filled with kibr, with haughtiness, with pride, to the extent that they cannot lower themselves to turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And how evil is that, Jamaatul Muslimin? If a person is unable to lower his head, to turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to admit his incapability, to admit his weakness, to acknowledge that he has no power, that he has no strength, that he has no control of the affairs of the world, he does not have control of his own affairs, forget about the affairs of the community, forget about the affairs of the globe. So, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَسْتَكْبِرُونَ عَنْ عِبَادَتِي, says Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, those who are too haughty and filled with pride to lower their heads and to turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, سَيَدَخُلُونَ جَهَنَّمَ الدَّاخِرِينَ. Allah says such people will enter the fire of Jahannam, humiliated. Another benefit of turning to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in dua is that, and this is a point that we've established, is that our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that dua is ibadah. In another tradition, the Prophet ﷺ says, dua is the mukh al-ibadah, it's the essence of worship. The essence, the secret, the access behind all acts of worship is dua, turning to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And therefore you'll find that there's no important ritual within Islam except that it comprises of dua, which is turning to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Dua is, of all acts of worship, dua is the most noble act of worship in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, Al-Imam At-Tirmidhi, or rather Al-Imam Ahmad rahimahullah ta'ala narrates from Abu Huraira radiallahu ta'ala an, that there is nothing more honorable in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than a person who turns to him in dua. Our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam does not emphasize these things for no reason, Jamaatul Muslimin. It's not emphasized in the Quran for no reason. Why would Allah dedicate so much ayat indicating its importance and virtue? Why did the Prophet ﷺ over within his sunnah speak about the virtue and the importance of dua? To the extent that he sees that the access of the essence of every act of worship is turning to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in dua, praying to him, asking of him. You know, how is it that we've become a community that is so heedless and neglectful of turning and making dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Today we barely have time to sit after salah to pray to Allah. And I'm not speaking about someone who's in favor of making dua after salah and not in favor. Everyone has his position that he wishes to adopt and he may follow. But the point is that how often do we raise our hands and turn to Allah in dua? Today we're so hasty that I pray my salah in the masjid and immediately afterwards I must stand up and go. You know, we don't have time any longer to turn to Allah. And even when we do turn to Allah, it just become a matter of protocol. I memorize a few du'as and I make those du'as day in and day out. Sometimes I don't know the meanings of those du'as. So what has become of us? When do I turn to Allah and speak to Him in my mother tongue? In English, or Afrikaans, or Khoza, or Chichewa, or whatever language. There's no language that Allah does not understand. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is constantly aware. He hears everything we say, He knows our thoughts. Therefore, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he told us in a tradition that if the entire human race, لَأَنَّ أَوَّلَكُمْ وَآخِرَكُمْ وَإِنسَكُمْ وَجِنَّكُمْ وَحَيَّكُمْ وَمَيِّتَكُمْ, should man and jinn, the beginning of you and the end of you, the living and the dead, should all of you gather on one plane, فَسَأَلُونِي, and were you to ask me. And we can only but imagine that from the time of Nabi Adam alayhi salam till the very last person to be on planet Earth, billions and billions and billions of men and billions of jinn all standing on a single plane talking to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Some shouting, some raising their voices, some speaking softly, some whispering, some asking Allah what their thoughts. You know, sometimes I stand and a person speaks to me, I can focus. Two people speak to you, you can try to somehow create a focus between the two of them. Three people speak, you lost. Four, even more lost. What about 10? What about 100? What about 1,000,000? We're not speaking about 1,000,000, we're speaking about billions and billions of people. Our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in this hadith Qudsi, the beginning of you, the end of you, the mankind, jinnkind, the living and the dead, if you are all together on one plane and speak to me, some shouting, some speaking quietly, some with a raised voice, some with a low voice, some in Urdu and some in Arabic, some in English and some in Afrikaans, hundreds of different of languages, some even thinking when turning to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that if all of you are to turn to me on one plane, I will give everyone his desire, even if it is the desire, the lowest desire of one of you should be 10 times more than this earth. I will grant everybody what he desires, and it won't decrease of my treasures and bounty, not as much as when a person takes a needle, places it in water, the amount of water that comes out from the ocean on the tip of that needle, not that amount will be decreased from my treasure, says Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So why are we not turning to this Allah? Do we doubt for 1 minute that Allah can solve our problems? Do we doubt for 1 minute that Allah can change the face of the international state of the Muslim globe? That same Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that assisted Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam on the day of Badr, when Allah sent down 300 angels. Some narrations say they were wearing white turbans, some narrations say they were wearing yellow turbans. The companions radiallahu ta'ala anhum narrate that before our blade reached the necks of the kuffar on the battle of Badr, you would find that the heads of the kuffar would fall off before our blade reached their necks. Do we doubt that same Allah who assisted Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his companions, can assist us? But we need to have hearts that are connected to Allah. Hearts like the companions were connected to Allah. If we turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this fashion, Allah will answer our call, like Allah answered the call of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam on the 17th night of Ramadan, when he stood the entire night crying before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Ya Hayyu Ya Qayyum, Ya Hayyu Ya Qayyum. Our Prophet called out to Allah, begged him and sought his assistance, and assistance came. We need hearts that are connected to Allah like the heart of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We need hearts that are connected to Allah like that of the companions. And we need to turn to Allah with such hearts. We need to turn to Allah with sincerity. We need to turn to Allah with sidq and truthfulness, pleading and begging on His door. So we're looking at some of the importance and benefits of turning to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he informed us that a person who makes dua, he pushes away the anger of Allah. And that the unspoken word there is a person who does not make dua, he's actually drawing the anger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said in a tradition narrated by Imam Ahmad as well as Imam At-Tirmidhi and Ibn Majah, that مَنْ لَمْ يَسْأَلِ اللَّهِ يَغْضَبْ عَلَيْهِ. That person who does not turn to Allah in dua, Allah becomes angry with him. In authentic hadith. So who can afford for Allah to be angry with him? That person who does not make dua. And again, I want to pose the question to myself and to the jama'ah. And this is something I must take serious. If I am someone that is sitting for a dua after a salah, and I'm listening to the imam make a dua, that's one thing. That's a dua of sorts. But when outside of the masjid, or inside of the masjid by myself, do I sit down and make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for myself? How often do I ask of Allah? How often do I speak to Him subhanahu wa ta'ala? And we see the state of the world. You know, the deeper problem is not the lack of dua, but the lack of concern. The deeper problem is that we live our lives and we are completely incognizant of what's happening around us. And the point we really want to come to is the massacre that is taking place within Egypt. You know, my intention is never to speak on politics, especially politics of the Middle East, because it's extremely complicated. But there's one thing that is not complicated, and that is that we have Muslim brothers around the world that is being slaughtered. Innocent people like you and I. Mothers like our mothers, and fathers like our fathers, and brothers like our brothers. Ordinary human beings such as you and I, believers in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, followers of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They're being slaughtered. But how is it affecting us? Never mind how it's affecting us, how is it affecting Muslims living within Egypt? Why thousands, according to the Ikhwani report, the report of the Muslim Brotherhood, nearly 4,000 people have been massacred. And Western media insist that it's a few hundred. They insist. They try to keep the number as low as possible. You know, we have Muslim brothers that the army is not allowing them to bury the Muslims, so they have masjids filled with Muslims, laying Muslim corpses, a masjid being used as morgues. The bodies cannot leave the masjid to the graveyard because the army won't allow them to do so. They have air cons on, they have ice placed over bodies to slow down the process of rotting. But they won't allow them to bury Muslims. You know, the state is really sad, Jamaat al-Muslimin. It's extremely sad. We're all pointing sometimes the finger at America, who is sponsoring the army 1.3 billion every year. Right, and we forget that the neighbor of Egypt, Saudi Arabia, gave the army as a gift 40 billion. It's unbelievable. And the reality is, Jamaat al-Muslimin, and this was very much my, and I'm very much off topic, but this was really my experiences when performing Umrah during the month of Ramadan. Just looking at the beautiful Kaaba, which is an ibadah, and seeing the amount of people that are streaming into the Haram, despite the fact that on our cell phones, the Saudi, the Idarat al-Shu'un of the Haram of Mecca, as well as Medina, they are encouraging people because of the renovation. I received in my short stay in Saudi Arabia two messages saying, please don't come to the Haram. Please don't make Tawaf, please don't make Umrah, because of the heavy crowds. Despite the steps and despite the fact that the Tawaf is limited, the place is packed. And there's just more and more people turning to this holy sanctuary. There's more and more people turning to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That on the one hand, on the other hand, one watches the news and sees the sad state of the Muslim world. You know, and the idea that becomes very predominant on my heart and in my mind is that Islam is like this ball or this bubble that is waiting to burst. You know, it's waiting to burst. It's filled to the brim. It wants to burst at its seams. You know, the beauty of Islam wants to reach all people around the world. And the kuffar and oppressors and the enemies of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they're trying to suppress this religion and oppress Muslims as far as possible. And therefore we find these events taking place throughout the world. You know, because it's all about suppressing Islam. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promises in His Quran when He says, يُرِيدُونَ أَن يُطْفِئُوا نُورَ اللَّهِ. They are trying to extinguish the light, the nur of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَيَأْبَى اللَّهِ. But Allah refuses. إِلَّا أَن يُتِمَّ نُورَهُ. Except to complete His nur. To see to it that Islam flourishes. To see to it that people will see the beauty of Islam. وَيَأْبَى اللَّهُ إِلَّا أَن يُتِمَّ نُورَهُ وَلَوْ كَرِهَ الْكَافِرُونَ. Even if the disbelievers dislike this. Even if the disbelievers are unhappy. Islam is a beautiful religion of peace. And that's the attitude of our Muslim brotherhood currently in Egypt. An attitude of peace. The message that comes from the office of the President of the United States is that the army and the Muslim brotherhood should retain themselves. La ilaha illallah. What retaining does a people do whose mothers were killed and fathers were killed and yet there's no weapons that they are picking up? And an army that is killing innocent civilians, they get the same orders like a party that has been massacred. Retain yourself. You know, the world keeps silent to such crimes. It really speaks of the sad situation of the Ummah. And therefore we speak of dua today, Jamaatul Muslimin, so that we can use this weapon that our Prophet ﷺ gave us. Silah al-Mu'min, the weapon of the believer. My bit that I can do is to ensure that I pick up my hand and I turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to change the situation of the Ummah. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant Muslims victory in the world. Ameen. That this beautiful message can reach the ears of every human being. The beauty of Islam. The peaceful nature of Islam. The tolerance of Islam. You know, and this should be everyone's desire. And there should be everyone's role. We should all see ourselves as vehicles of da'wah, of wanting to show the world the beauty of this message. And to what extent are we showing people? And therefore reformation of the self is so important. Wherever I go, people should see this is Islam. When I'm enjoying myself on the beach, people should see this is Islam. When I'm sitting in my office, people should see this is Islam. Are we showing this to the world? Our Prophet ﷺ, coming back to the importance of dua, He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that it pushes away the anger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that person who does not turn to Allah in dua, Allah is angry with him. And this is not the same like human beings. For Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cannot be compared to his human beings in no way. One of the poets, they beautifully stated that لَتَسْأَلَنَّ بُنَيَّ آدَمَ حَاجَةً. Do not ask the son of Adam anything. وَسَلِ الَّذِي أَبْوَابُهُ لَا تُحْجَبُ. But ask the one subhanahu wa ta'ala whose doors are not closed. Allahu yaghdab in turikat su'aluhu. When you stop asking Allah, Allah becomes angry. Wa bunayya adam hina yus'alu yaghdabu. While the children of Adam, when you start asking them, they become angry. Our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he taught us the manner in which we should make dua. How do we turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And perhaps we're not implementing these points. And we find that our du'as are not accepted. So our Prophet ﷺ, he encouraged us not only verbally but in terms of his action. He showed us when a person makes du'a, you begin by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. On one occasion, the Prophet ﷺ, he entered his masjid and he found a man sitting after he prayed salah. And the man made a du'a, Allahumma ghfirli warhamni. Oh Allah, forgive me and have mercy upon me. And the Prophet ﷺ told the person who just performed salah, that you have hastened into your dua. أَجَلْتَ أَيُّهَا الْمُصَلِّ إِذَا صَلَّيْتَ فَقَعَدْتَ فَأَحْمَدِ اللَّهَ بِمَا هُوَ أَهْلُهُ وَصَلِّ عَلَيَّ ثُمَّ ادْعُهُ. If you are done with your prayer, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, and you're sitting, then before making dua, first praise Allah. اللهم لك الحمد كله ولك الشكر كله. Turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and praise Him. After praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, send salutations upon me, says Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And that's the format that our du'as would normally take within our masajid. So it's first praising Allah, sending salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then ask, says Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Another man, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, saw him praying and he completed his salah and he praised Allah and he sent salutations upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told that musalli, after praising Allah and sending salutations upon the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Prophet said to him, make dua now, O musalli, because your dua will be accepted. You know, thana, praising Allah and sending salutations upon his Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he informed us in another tradition that every dua is mahjoor. This really emphasizes the position our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the importance of sending salutations upon him. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says every dua is mahjoor. It's stuck between the heavens and the earth. It cannot reach Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala until you send salutations upon me, said Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So forget about the dua being accepted if I cannot send as part of my dua salutations upon Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allahumma salli wa sallim ala Sayyidina Muhammad nurika sarni wa madatika aljari wajma'na biha fi qulli al-atwari wa ala ali wa sahbiyya nur. The next important point of dua from the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is al-iqrar bil-dham, admitting your sin, acknowledging your sin. Wal-i'tiraf bil-khati'ah. So we find Abi Yunus alayhi salam, when he made dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, his dua was one that he said to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, La ilaha illa anta subhanaka inni kuntu min al-zalimin. Glory be to you, Allah, I am from the wrongdoers. Admit your incapability, admit your shortcoming. And we all fall short when it comes to the ibadah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We all fall short when it comes to our tilawatul Quran and our dhikr and being in the masjid and spending time in the masjid and praying our salah in jama'ah. So admit our shortcomings, an essential quality for a person who wishes his dua to be accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And therefore we find that our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he taught us the Sayyidul Istighfar. The Prophet called it the master of all forms of istighfar. And we're fortunate that we recite it every morning in the masjid. Those brothers who take the time out to be part of the dhikr that is recited in the masjid. Our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he taught us and he told us that the Sayyidul Istighfar, when the person recites, Allahumma anta rabbi, oh Allah, you are my Lord. La ilaha illa anta, there is no God but you. Khalaqtani, you have created me. Wa ana abduk, I am your servant. وَأَنَا عَلَىٰ أَهْدِكَ وَوَعْدِكَ مَسْتَطَعْتَ. I will fulfill the covenant that I've taken from you to the best of my ability. أَبُوءُ لَكَ بِنِعْمَتِكَ عَلَيْهَا. I acknowledge your favor upon me. وَأَبُوءُ بِذَنْبِ. And I acknowledge my sins. I acknowledge my shortcomings. An important quality when turning to Allah. You know, teach yourself that you are useless. Teach yourself that in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you are not worthy of anything. And therefore you are completely left to His mercy. You are completely left to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I acknowledge my sin. وَأَبُوءُ بِذَنْبِي فَغْفِرْ لِي فَإِنَّهُ لَا يَغْفِرُ الذُّنُوبَ إِلَّا أَنْتَ. Forgive me Allah, for no one but you can forgive sins. Acknowledging your sin when turning to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in dua. Our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said the person who recites this in the morning and he dies during that day, or the person who recites it at night and he dies during that evening, he is from the people of Jannah. فَهُوَ مِنْ أَهْلِ الْجَنَّةِ, said Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Another important quality that one needs to adopt within his dua is tadarru', lowering yourself, humbling yourself before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes his pious servants in the Quran when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَدْعُونَنَا رَغَبًا وَرَهَبًا وَكَانُوا لَنَا خَاشِعِينَ. They call unto us, they make dua unto us, رَغَبًا وَرَهَبًا, desiring and hopeful of our mercy and hopeful of our reward. وَرَهَبًا, fearing our anger and fearing our punishment. وَكَانُوا لَنَا خَاشِعِينَ, they are humble before us. They have the quality of khushu, lowering the heads. Another important quality that our Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he teaches us, is al-jazm fi dua. A believer does not make dua, Ya Allah, grant me something if you want. Ya Allah, if you want to forgive me, then forgive me. That's not the way a believer makes dua. He has to have the quality of jazm. He needs to be assertive in his dua. Beg and plead from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. والعزم في المسألة. أبو هريرة رضي الله تعالى عنه narrated from the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم لا يقولن أحدكم, none of you should say اللهم اغفر لي إن شئت, forgive me if you wish, اللهم ارحمني إن شئت, have mercy upon me if you wish. ليعزم المسألة. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said be determined in your dua. فإنه لا مستقر له. Another quality we need to develop in our dua from the sunnah of Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم is إلحاح, which is very much similar to the previous one. Persist, continue asking and asking and asking and don't stop. Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam informed us that no dua of a servant is rejected by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In one hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us that two things happen to a dua. Either Allah accepts your dua or Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala removes harm away from you in proportion to the dua that you have made. In another hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam informed us that three things will happen to a dua. Either Allah accepts it immediately, or Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grants it to you at a later point in your life, or He grants it to you in paradise. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, as long as one of you does not hasten in his dua. Hastening in the dua means that you turn to Allah and say, Allah, I asked you but you did not give me. Doing such removes the dua. Allah won't grant it to me if I adopt such an attitude. Another important quality that our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught us is that We should turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at all times. Dua is not only when things are not in our favor. Dua not only at times of difficulty or adversity. Dua is to be made at all times. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he told us in a hadith that man sarrahu an yastajib Allahu lahu inda shada'idi wal kurab. That person who wishes that Allah answers his du'as at times of difficulty, at times of adversity, فَلْيُكْثِرْ مِنَ الدُّعَى فِي الرَّخَى. He should make excessive dua at times of ease. If I accustom myself to turning to Allah in dua at times of ease, then when difficulty comes my way, Allah will hasten in accepting my dua. You know, so the point we're coming to, Jamaatul Muslimin, and we have to conclude, is that we Muslims living all the way in the Western Cape, the tip of Africa, you feel very, very helpless when it comes to the situation of our Muslim brothers around the world. You know, the question comes up, what can I do? And there are some good efforts where one could contribute money towards a cause. That's important on the one hand. But perhaps more important than contributing wealth and more important than giving sadaqah is this powerful weapon. And this is the gist of our talk. The powerful weapon that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us, the weapon of dua. And it's a weapon that Muslims must start using. You know, so we conclude and we praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is in power, in control of anything. All praise belongs to Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. We send salutations upon our Master Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammad wa ala ali Sayyidina Muhammadin wa ashabi wa barik wa sallim. And we turn to Allah asking Him that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brings relief to the Muslim ummah and home. Specifically our Muslim brothers that are suffering in Egypt. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it easy for those families who lost loved ones, be it mothers, be it daughters, be it sisters, be it brothers. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward those who have lost their lives and Allah grant him high places in Jannah. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it possible for the Muslim to have the deceased and the dead buried in the soonest possible time. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make the graves gardens of paradise. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala resurrect him in the company of the Anbiya and the Shuhada and the martyrs in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bring relief. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bring relief. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala change the affairs of the Muslim ummah. And may this ummah Islam lead the world once again. May the whole world, every human being, see the beauty of Islam. You know, and this is a beauty that we, the greatest injustice that we are doing to the world is by keeping this beauty with us. We need to start sharing this beauty. My neighbors, my colleagues, that was the whole world, is to see the beauty of this message of Habibuna Muhammad sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. وبهذا القدر نكتفي وآخر دعوانا الحمد لله.